Madam Speaker, it's my pleasure to rise in the House today to debate the motion put forward by the Conservative Party on the issue of the energy sector and oil pipelines in Canada. As this is my first speech in this Parliament, I'd like to take a moment to thank the people of Chilliwack and Hope for once again placing their trust in me to serve them as their Member of Parliament. None of us get here without the tireless work of our volunteers, and I would like to thank my amazing team in Chilliwack Hope for their efforts over a very long and difficult campaign. And last but not least, I'd like to thank my wife Lisa and my son McLean for their love and support, not just during the campaign, but always. Mr. Speaker, we've seen over the last number of months the devastating job numbers coming out of Alberta and Saskatchewan. Over 100,000 jobs lost in the energy sector and related sectors alone. But this is not just an Alberta issue. This is an issue affecting all Canadians, and I want to share some insight into the effect that this is having on my own riding and my hometown. Now, I don't seek to compare my situation with those, the situation in my region, with those more affected, but I want to show you that families are hurting right across the country. In the last Parliament, I spoke to the House about the benefits of the energy sector in Chilliwack, even though we're 1,500 kilometres away from Fort McMurray and the heart of the oil patch. Hundreds of local manufacturing jobs were created by businesses big and small. These are companies that are on the leading edge of innovation, efficiency and productivity, which is why it was so disappointing to hear the Prime Minister insult the energy sector as not being resourceful when he was gallivanting around with anti-energy celebrities at a Swiss ski hill in Davos earlier this month. Just a short time ago, Britco Structures, located in the nearby district of Kent, had over 200 employees building housing units which were going into the many work camps utilized by energy companies operating in remote locations in the oil patch. Many of their employees live in Chilliwack. These were family-supporting, well-paying, skilled labour positions. Today, Brit goes down to a skeleton crew, operating on work-sharing programs in order to ensure that as many employees as possible can try to make ends meet. Nearly an entire workforce wiped out by the crisis in the energy sector. They're hopeful that new contracts will be won and they can bring back some of those who have been laid off, but right now it's not a good situation. Another local success story in my riding is Ticrop Manufacturing, a 35-year-old product creation company that specializes in designing, engineering, and building mobile industrial equipment solutions. Again, a very resourceful company that relies in large part on the oil and gas sector. I contacted one of the owners of Ticrop last night, and here's what he told me. Rosedale Ticrop has laid off over 100 staff, or roughly $7 million in payroll affecting Chilliwack and surrounding areas, Hope, Abbotsford and Langley. We estimate that in excess of another 100 jobs of equal value have been lost by contract supply partners to Ticrop with a similar payroll value. The impact is severe, with no new orders in sight. I just checked my email and there were 5 new layoffs today alone. We could not carry these people any longer. There's nothing for them to do. Dozens of highly skilled jobs were lost at IMW Industries in Chilliwack as well, as the market for their compressed natural gas products dried up. Hundreds of family-supporting manufacturing jobs have been lost in my riding. But it's not just highly skilled manufacturing jobs that have been affected, Madam Speaker. At Christmas time, I spoke with Gordon, the operator of the Slot Car Palace, an old-school toy store in Chilliwack, full of Lego, board games, model tanks and airplanes, and all sorts of amazing things for the young and young at heart. I asked Gordon how it was going. Unprompted, he told me how the downturn in the oil patch, 1,500 kilometres away, was having a negative impact on his small business. Several of his best customers had been laid off and could no longer afford to buy Christmas presents. They had less. And now so did he, and he was worried about what that would mean for him in the short and long term. There are hundreds of stories like that across my riding and tens of thousands of stories like that right across the country. Canex Building Supplies, a major building supply operation in Chilliwack, reports receiving dozens of resumes from highly paid laborers returning to Chilliwack from Alberta, desperate to get an entry-level job in their lumber yard. I've heard similar stories from extended family members who are fortunately still employed in the oil and gas sector in Alberta. Hundreds of applications for single job openings with all of the applicants hopelessly overqualified. Accounts receivables issues, with invoices worth hundreds of thousands of dollars or more not being paid on time, if at all. A massive increase in the use of food banks. A massive increase in property crime. These are desperate times, which is why it was so callous and so outrageous to hear the Liberal Minister of Veterans Affairs from Calgary state in the House this week that the people of Alberta were feeling refreshed and excited. My family in Alberta is not feeling refreshed. They are feeling anxious. They are worried. They are concerned, and they're looking for some sign of hope that it's going to get better. And that's where our support for environmentally sustainable economic development comes in. That's where our support for the energy sector is so critical. That's where our support in principle for safe, efficient energy infrastructure, like the Energy East pipeline, comes in. Approving these projects would send a message of hope to the people who've lost their jobs and those who worry they will, that there is a better future in the energy sector and that the situation is going to improve, that Canadians will finally start to get world price for the oil that we've been blessed with, that Canadian oil will be used in Canadian refineries, that the companies who are laying off workers will be able to survive and expand their workforces when market conditions improve. Conservatives have always been clear. We will only support pipelines if they are safe for Canadians and safe for the environment. When we were in government, we imposed hundreds of conditions on the pipeline projects that were approved. We demanded world-class marine spill response, world-class monitoring, world-class construction, and world-class standards. We did this by investing in world-class science. All independent analysis shows that pipelines are the safest way to transport petrochemicals. That is a simple fact. And if this new government actually believes in evidence-based policy making, then they should approve those pipeline projects that are shown to be safe and should drop their ideological opposition to the energy sector. Every Canadian is supported either directly or indirectly by this sector. Energy products heat our homes, power our vehicles, help us move goods and people across the country. The energy sector provides royalties and tax revenues that support our local hospitals and schools. It provides money for infrastructure. It should be valued, cherished, and nurtured, not ridiculed, belittled, and berated, which is what this new government has done to them in such a short time in office. Here. I want to tell you a bit about my friends, Jeff and Marcy. They live in Chilliwack, and Jeff works in the oil patch, leaving behind his wife and two kids for weeks at a time. It's a tough trade-off, but one that they've decided to make in order to get ahead financially. Because Jeff's been promoted to a senior position, he hasn't experienced the layoff that hundreds of his friends and co-workers have. But he's worried that it could happen, and he told me what that would mean for his family. Marcy would have to go back to work and could no longer homeschool their kids, which is what is best for them because of their son's health issues. Extras like the sports and music lessons would be gone. The financial security that they have sacrificed for would disappear. But Jeff feels fortunate. While he worries, others are experiencing what he fears. These are not statistics. These are our friends and neighbors. And the decision that the government makes has a real impact on their future. Canadians know that we don't control the price of a barrel of oil. Those who've been laid off don't expect that by debating this issue in the House of Commons that we can suddenly reverse this downward trend. But what they do expect is that we will be on their side, that we will fight for them, and that we will do everything we can to support the energy industry and the energy infrastructure that supports their families. They need a government like our previous Conservative government that supports sustainable, responsible resource development. Supporting this motion before us today signals our support for the energy sector. It shows Canadians who are hurting that we care and that we're working for them and for a future where they can return to work and continue to provide for their families and continue to build this country. Here, here.